Hey, you looking for a way to unschool, unlearn, and unplug? You're on the right frequency then. Holistic wellness, natural law, spiritual teachings, esoteric science, suppressed history, survivalism for the road ahead, and a return to what makes humans human. Unhinged, unrestrained, uncensored. If you're weak of mind or of heart, this is not for you. Because this is Detox. Hey yo, from the Kingdom of Ohio, you have entered that phase known as detox, where we're deconstructing your reality one birth certificate at a time. My name is Ryan Thomas, because those were the last names that I was given, and if you're on that wavelength with me, you're going to enjoy this ride. Anyway, welcome to the D program. In this episode, my guest is Cal Washington, a rather litigious living man from north of the border in Western Canada. Cal's work in and around lawful matters began when he went through a divorce and took it upon himself to learn the substance, process, and procedure of the law, in addition to its many faceted jurisdictions and tongue-twisting trickeries. And after months and years of research and experience, he found himself on the winning end of a $300 million case where he put the crown itself into default and proved that the power really does reside in the hands and hearts of living men and women. Cal then went on to co-found InPower Movement, whose principal mission is reclaiming authority over one's health and one's home via an original document Cal authored called the Notice of Liability, which can be used to fight the good fight against smart meters, 5G, geoengineering, and forced vaccinations. He's the man who puts the word author in authority, a real down-in-earth kind of guy, if you know what I mean, and a godsend if there ever was one. So let's slap on our discernment caps and ready our quills and our inkwells, and let Cal Washington seduce us with his sweet, sweet badass song that resonates on earth as it does in heaven. Enjoy. Cal Washington, welcome to what I call the D program. Thanks for being here.
Oh, thanks. I'm happy to be here, right?
Yeah, I am happy that you're here as well, for sure. So Cal, you have no driver's license, no bank account. You call the Bible a contract. I've heard you talk about portals and slowing time down. I think we'll have a pretty wild chat here and get to hopefully all of that and more over the course of the next 2 hours. But before we do, I know you've told your story 1,000 times at this point, and I hesitate to even ask the whole, how did you get into this question? So I'm actually not going to, but we do need to lay a foundation for the audience. And I don't want to pigeonhole you as just the law merchant guy, because from what I've heard, you're so much more than that. So I thought a better way to frame up the conversation would be for you to tell us a bit about the spiritual foundation that you have, because I think that does a better job of characterizing you and your journey to this point. So what kind of environment were you raised in regards to spirituality? And how would you characterize the impact that your faith has had on your life as you look back on where you've came from and where you're at now?
As a child, we didn't grow up with much faith. My mother sent us to church when we were really young, like grade 1, grade 2. And then we moved and we just didn't go to a new one. And then when I was 17, I went to a young people's thing at my aunt and uncle's church with my cousin. I became a Christian then when I was about 17. So my faith is Christian. As I went into my 20s, I kind of backed away from the church. So I read a bunch of other philosophies and, you know, studied different things. So I'm pretty well-rounded. Then I came back to, I wanted to read Jesus's words. So I just went back to a Bible and read all the red letters. I just wanted to get, you know, like, what did he say without all the rest of it? He was definitely different. And so, you know, I just kind of reconfirmed my faith in Christianity, but I still do have knowledge of other belief systems and it had, you know, a few experiences that I can't deny. And so I'm kind of well-rounded, but my core belief is the Bible and the stories, or however you want to describe those things in the Bible, as being a real guide and a truth, although it's sometimes, you know, allegorical, but you can glean the truths and they still line up with all the other things that I understand as well. So it has not contradicted in, you know, the way people might think, but it does give you a blueprint of what's going on and how to like how to get back to the garden, so to speak. And so that's my core beliefs.
Yeah. And I mean, you've said before that the Bible is your cognitive bias. I like that you're upfront about that, just so people know where it is you're coming from. I think I might have a cognitive bias that leans more toward the occult. And I know you're probably familiar with that body of spiritual belief or practice. I don't really do that. I'm not really into that anymore. But I spent several years sort of, I guess, as an intellectual and a philosophical pursuit, just trying to comprehend what that body of practice and body of spiritual belief was. And it's funny, you know, you say that the Bible is kind of a blueprint for everything, right? It's sort of the rules of engagement, I think you've said before too.
Yeah.
I feel like the occult though, I don't know how much you know about it, but I feel like that is also in some way a blueprint for what's happening now in the world. I mean, what do you understand about the occult and how do you see it manifesting in reality here right now?
Well, occult means secret. So I'm not sure what exactly you mean by, you know, occult teachings, but getting into any kind of Satanism or witchcraft, that kind of thing, you know, they have hijacked certain, you know, the way things work, like the way this matrix works. So they understand that there is some truth in that as far as that goes. Like they do understand how, what this thing is and how it works, but there's still an underlying, the thing of trying to disengage from God. And that's one of the big differences. And even in some cases, trying to overcome God or overthrow God, if they do understand who God is. That's my understanding of it. I mean, I've heard some manly stuff, and you know, I've studied the Egyptian mystery school stuff to a degree, and nothing. I've never, you know, dived into it, but I do understand what, you know, what was going on a little more than most would that are involved with Christianity.
Yeah, I asked that question because I feel like a lot of, you know, not just the spiritual stuff that we'll be talking about, but also the law stuff is very occulted, not just in a sense that it's secret or it's hidden away from society, but it does have this, it's quite esoteric. You know, it's really hard to comprehend all this. And it's really hard to just read it on the surface. I think of like magical texts and grimoires and like alchemical treatises and the language that they use and the symbols that they use. It's all very hard to comprehend. It reminds me of what you do when you get into law, like the way that you're reading through statutes and the way that you're reading through legal paperwork and whatever else. So I just thought there might have been a parallel there that you could see, you know, not just on the surface, but also just going into the depths of these subjects. So
there's a definite parallel, and especially with the English language, the language itself is probably contrived. I've read quite a bit about that, so that it can be manipulated. And things can be disguised. You can have double meanings, all kinds of things go on that are, you know, I guess occultish or hidden. I call it word magic. And yeah, there's a definite parallel there where things may mean one thing at one level and other things at other levels of reading and understanding the language. So yeah, there's a definite parallel. You know, there's a legal language. I think a lot of people call it legalese. And it takes a while to be able to read that stuff, but you got to use dictionaries. You really, you know, there's no shortcut there. I didn't try and pretend like I understood words. And even if I did understand them, I would still look them up to see if there's a second definition and then plug that definition into the sentence. And it takes on a whole new life and all that. Right. So, yeah.
Yeah. So in regards then to your expertise in law, which is a big reason why you're here, obviously, we do have to touch on that up front. Could you briefly tell us about what this term law merchant jurisdiction is, what it means, and, you know, where you were at in your life when you first came across that term and really started to understand it?
Well, law merchant is ancient, but when I discuss, I kind of go just back to the Middle Ages when they were doing international fairs throughout Europe, the known area at the time. It was a jurisdiction for the merchant class only. So it was autonomous. It had its own rules. The rules were not written down. It was more like customs and procedures and principles. It was based on principles and truth being one of those. But you could get to the truth quite quickly. You didn't have to go through the arduous proving every fact. A lot of it relied on probabilities. And it's prevalent in the court now. They call it summary judgment. And they can make judgments based on probabilities rather than actual facts. When I discovered it, I was already immersed in the court. I had tried many different tactics that I learned from different guys that were teaching their take on what the government was, what the courts were, you know, how everything worked. And so I tried a lot of different things. I read a lot of Acts, and that's when I learned, you know, how to read Acts and decipher sentences using dictionaries and my knowledge of grammar. So when I was exposed to Law Merchant, the light bulbs went off for me because I wasn't getting much traction in there. It seemed like I had the better arguments most of the time because I could tell by the body language, like, oh, you know, you nailed it, but they still wouldn't rule in my favor. And once I saw a seminar on Law Merchant, or on commercial processes, which ended up being Law Merchant, that's when the light bulbs went off. I could see why I was losing. I could see why they were doing certain things because it baffled me. But now it all started to make sense. There was the puzzle pieces started to make sense. But the puzzle that I could see wasn't the picture on the box. Normally when you buy a jigsaw puzzle, there's a picture on the box and all the pieces are supposed to make that picture. Well, if you go with that assumption and the pieces don't fit, then you're like, why is this not looking like the picture on the box? So you have to kind of go with what the actual puzzle is doing. And my exposure to commerce really started to make sense. Everything started to like, okay, now I know why that was and that was and why they're acting that way. And it all started to make sense.
Yeah. So those original methods that you were using, they obviously didn't work because of what you call commerce, because of Law Merchant. I heard you say once too, that you had other agreements going on and that's how the court would get jurisdiction over you. When you say you had other agreements going on and that's how they would get jurisdiction on you, what other agreements do you mean? Do you mean the agreements you came into this life with from like another realm, or are you talking like other legal jurisdictions?
I was probably talking about legal jurisdictions. One being your postal address. And I didn't realize this, but a good friend of mine, he's passed on now, but deep researcher, and he explained how the post office worked. And the stamp is general delivery. So the person sending something puts a stamp on there. That goes to the post office. That's as far as that money takes it. The government then gives you a benefit of taking it from the post office to your house. I didn't realize that. So they're still operating under general delivery where everybody had to go to the post office to get their mail, like when towns were smaller. That's just how it was done. As things got bigger, that wasn't practical at all. So mail had to be delivered. It's that delivery that the government kind of took over. So that's a benefit. And if you're realizing a benefit, then you have to take part in the rest of whatever they're doing as well, because you're getting that benefit. So I didn't understand that. And so I got a mailbox and rerouted all my mail there. And that became my person's postal address, which I still use today.
So you wrote on your website then that Law Merchant is not codified law. So if that's true, how could anyone then be subject to its jurisdiction?
Well, it's not codified because it was for the merchant class and they all understood it because it was a small portion of the population. They all got great advantage from it, and it was balanced and it kept everybody honest and you could get remedy very quickly. And so they all agreed to this. This is this works, and it's dynamic. It's not based on rule number 1.3. It's based on what's happening today, who's here, what took place. And they just kind of move through things quickly. But what happened is they fused it with the common law in the 1700s. In order to get more people using the king's courts rather than the staple courts. So the judges were to take judicial notice of the Law Merchant if a commercial thing came in, so that all the merchants could come to that building with that judge, but still operate under Law Merchant, like still move very quickly through it. Then just through time, people stopped talking about it, really, but it's still there. And then in the 30s or like 1929-ish, when they crashed the stock market, that's when they brought the birth certificates in, you know, in the early 30s. There were birth certificates before that, but that's when they really brought it out, where you had to register your child. That registration, that birth certificate, created a fictional person, which is a merchant. So they turned us all into merchants so that they could use this hidden occult, if you want to put it that way, this jurisdiction. And there's a letter from Colonel Mandel House to Woodrow Wilson, and it's mentioned exactly what they were going to do, how they were going to register us as chattel, and they were going to use through operation of the Law Merchant is written right in that letter. Then they will be able to amass riches.
So you'll find some people that will take issue with that statement about the birth certificate being, you know, like essentially the contract that then puts you into this merchant class, right? And creates your legal fiction and your corporate person. There's a lot of chatter online about, you know, I think people call it patriot mythology. And what do you say to the people who think that that's all kind of bogus, you know, who think that that's all either not true or exaggerated or whatever?
Well, I can tell you from my own experience that it is true, because I've done processes with my birth certificate in the U.S. Treasury, and the instruments that I write based on that make judges run out of the room. And I had many years of judges not running out of the room. Matter of fact, judges being very aggressive, and, you know, I spent many times arrested and yelled at and all that stuff. It instantly changed. So these people that think they know, they obviously know more than these judges, because these judges were definitely, they wouldn't admit that it was there, but all their actions showed that they were definitely aware of this and quite afraid of it. So they took it seriously. Another thing about the law merchant is there's a lot of people saying that law merchant was a myth. There's quite a few treatises out there. One of the treatises I saw even gave examples of, because they have scrolls still from those days, of actual cases. So just because it wasn't codified doesn't mean there wasn't something going on, because there's actual case law on scrolls and you can read these. So it was happening. Just because it wasn't codified doesn't make it a myth.
Right. Yeah. It's all very esoteric. It's all very hard to understand or comprehend. So I feel like there's a lot of snake oil out there too, on some level with this stuff. And there are people just, I think, trying to profit off of it. You know, like I went through this rabbit hole where I was researching, like, correcting my status, you know, and I don't know if you know what that term means. I don't know if it's a thing up there, but I still don't know what to make of it. Like, I'm not sure, like, what's true and what's not in this arena here. So just, you know, want to throw that question out there just to not necessarily get you to verify this for me, but just, you know, just want your thoughts on it, because there are a lot of differing opinions and perspectives, and there's camps of people that say one thing and there's camps of people who swear by a whole other thing.
Yeah. Well, I can't talk about, you know, exiting strategies. I did my own, but, or changing your status. I will tell you, they may not recognize it, even if you do go through it, but still going through it, if you fully understand what you're doing and inside you understand what it is you're doing, then it will become real for you. So it's not just processes or pieces of paper. I'll tell you that. But as far as the birth certificate goes, the birth certificate is real. There is a SESTA KV trust. Now, how to access that, like in order to get any gain from it, I don't talk about that. I don't even pursue that. But I have used that trust in certain ways and got, you know, massive results. I also saw, for years, we were trying to find the CUSIP numbers where your accounts are lodged. And in the last couple of years, I found one. There was a guy who could get the CUSIP numbers, and we tried it on just a small case in Illinois. And he got the CUSIP numbers, and there was her name and the mutual funds or whatever they were that were on the stock market and the amounts of her trust. There was about two or three things on there. And yeah, it's all real.
That's wild, because I've heard for years that, like, the birth certificate's been traded on the stock market. I've heard you talk about court orders also being traded on the stock market, because those carry real value in the law merchant system. That is money to them. And so that gives a lot more character to what I've heard. And I'm just still unsure, like, if these things are being traded, they should be able to be tracked. They should be able to be monitored.
They are.
Can I access that stuff? I think that's what you were just, you know, sort of talking about. But can the average person, like, it sounds like you have to do a lot of digging, a lot of research just to even find out where you can look at these trust numbers, look at these transactions, you know, it's not like there's a central database out there that we all know of.
Yeah, there is. The stock market is one. You just have to have, you have to be able to access that. So it's not open to everybody. The guy that found it, he knew somebody who had access to that system. And he goes, oh yeah, I see those things go across all the time and nobody pays attention to them, because they blend in with the rest of everything that's going on. But once you punch in the name or maybe a social security number, you'll get that fund and you'll see where it is, like, and the amounts.
Well, I know what I'll be doing this weekend then. So, but, you know, I know you did a lot of your, you've done a lot of your law work, lawful work, let's call it lawful work in Canada. So I'm curious, because I do have a primarily US-based audience, what are the differences between Canada and the US in regards to law merchant?
The law merchant is running in the United States just as it is in Canada. And in Canada, you can actually see it because, you know, we've had lawyers write back and say, you know, law merchants is a myth or there's no basis in law. Or, you know, like it's ridiculous to even talk about that. And then I point them to Bills of Exchange Act, Section 9, where it says, except where expressly said by this very act, the Bills of Exchange Act, all instruments will be run by the common law, including the law merchant. And there it is. So there it is on a federal Canadian act where they use the word law merchant. And if it didn't exist, why was that in there?
Yeah. Let me ask you something then. I'm not sure how familiar you are with the US court system and our constitution, but it seems like that the constitution, it gets sort of propped up as this end all be all document. But a lot of the things that I've seen over the last 15 years of my life, as I've gotten a little more awake and aware and hip to the legal game as well, the Constitution doesn't seem to really apply much in these court settings. Is this why then?
Yes. The court setting is part of the corporation and you can't take the Constitution into those places. It doesn't work there. Same as going to your boss at work and going, I'm taking tomorrow off because it says here in the Constitution, I have the right to be free or pursue happiness. I'd rather be at the beach tomorrow. So I'm using the Constitution and I'm not coming to work tomorrow. They would look at you like, what are you talking about? Well, the court does that too. It's like, what are you talking about? This is a business called the court. It has nothing to do with the Constitution. Mm-hmm.
So where the hell does the Constitution apply then?
It applies to the Republic and maybe at the Supreme Court level of the United States. You can have stuff heard there, but in your local court, that's a corporation.
Hmm. That makes more sense. Yeah. Because it does seem like when these things trickle up to the Supreme Court that they obviously have the power and the oversight and the jurisdiction to overrule things that occurred in these lower courts. And if these lower courts are operating more in the law merchant jurisdiction in the Supreme Court, one, that sounds very biblical, doesn't it? The Supreme Court, it sounds like something straight out of Job, right? So,
right.
Yeah, maybe they are operating at a different jurisdiction there. I don't know. I've never been there. Hopefully I never go there. But, you know, it just seems like that they do have the authority to bring that word back in to reinforce the law of the land, right?
Exactly. But it's hard to get that far. So that's the thing. And people give up. And it's probably costly. It's costly here to go to the Supreme Court of Canada because it's just one court. They turn away most of the applications. Like they just, nope. You know, so you can't even be heard there. Well, you're not guaranteed of being heard there. So it's kind of a bad situation. Mm-hmm. And I just found that if I go straight to law merchant and deal with these people mano a mano, they butted out of my life. And that's just what happened. So,
yeah. So all of your work then has set the foundation for and then led to the creation of the InPower Movement, where you specialize in the notice of liability. So tell us a little bit about what that term means and how it was created, because I know that there was some spiritual inspiration there as well, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Everything's spiritual. Like everything that happens here is, you know, there's that old cult saying, as above, so below. There's different levels of everything happening and one mirrors the other and one supersedes the other too. So the higher jurisdiction you can understand and operate in, the more the lower jurisdictions follow suit. So that like the 3D world follows something else. And so when I left court, they owed me $300 million. They put it in the newspaper, was on the, you know, on the news, etc. They didn't say, you know, not that they owed me, but they owed that exact amount. It can't be a coincidence that I send something there and then a couple of days later, they're bringing everybody back from their holidays for the legislature. And then they, you know, put it out in the newspaper and the news that they lost $300 million. So they were admitting to it. Through all that, I met, because people were starting to seek me out because they heard all this was going on, like typical sort of, you know, patriot lore. And I met Josh Del Sol and we became friends over the years. Then he made a movie, Take Back Your Power. I helped him, you know, get an editor for that, who was one of the guys that I was working with and all this stuff. Later on, after he was showing the movie, it was a well-done movie, but they left leaving the theater or after watching it in a very despondent, you know, we're all going to die kind of state. And so he was wondering if, you know, if there was a solution and because he, you know, knew about everything that I had done, he asked me to write a document. So I did it based on the $300 million document that caused so much angst here in Canada, just took parts of that and then formed this thing on the smart meter issue. He asked me to come and speak on it. I didn't want to, so he convinced me. And the room kind of lit up when I was speaking, and I hadn't seen that before. I'd done the odd speaking thing, but usually one or two people kind of, oh, but all of a sudden everybody kind of was just like turned on. So it was very different. Within a month, we were in Detroit doing the same thing. And again, the room lit up, and one thing just led to another. So it wasn't that we sat there and planned this out. It was more of a, we were just following a leading.
Where was the sort of divine inspiration then? Like, where did that come from for this document?
Well, we use the Bible, and my understanding of Law Merchant follows biblical principles. So the Law Merchant, when you really start to study it, it's the same thing as written in the Bible on how to conduct yourself in this world. You want to settle with your brother on the way to court. There's a verse in there about that. Many different principles of biblical principles are Law Merchant principles. They're one's copying the other. And I understood what was going on with the meters, that they were using Law Merchant, using tacit agreement. As soon as I see tacit agreement, I know, okay, you're moving in this other realm where that operates. And so it just became understanding what this was about at the highest levels. And then over time, you start to see more and more and more. And then you start to understand your document even more and more and more. And it starts to have far-reaching ramifications into other realms, into the spiritual realm. And the court case has been running there for eons. And now we're coming with evidence and orders, et cetera, et cetera. And our agreements that can be adjudicated in a higher realm, which puts the system into a default. That's the main thing that we're trying to get, is enough people doing this thing that we can bring the whole system into a default situation and have it removed.
Yeah. I've heard you say that truth is established by affidavit. And that's another term along these same lines, the affidavit. Is there a difference between that term and your notice of liability, or are they the same thing?
We have an affidavit as part of the notice of liability. That's one of the differences, because there's quite a few notices of liability out there now. I haven't read most of them. Some of them are missing some parts, and you got to have an affidavit to operate in Law Merchant to get the truth, because the truth is the point that you're making your claim based on. So you can make claims till you're blue in the face, and they can even be truthful claims, but if you don't do it in the correct way, then it's not considered as truth. Another thing that could be a lie could be considered the truth, as you can see in the world. There's a lot going on where truth is being skewed, but it still stands as truth.
That reminds me of what I learned about magic when I was reading about that a lot, was there are specific steps you have to take in a very specific order, or else the magic doesn't work. And so this is kind of in the same realm, right? Your intention has to be clear. Your wording has to be precise, or else this thing will not fly. So it is crazy, the parallels that I'm seeing here with lawfulness and legal jurisdiction, and then the occult systems that I've read about for many years now. So it just, it's one of those things that just continues to sort of baffle me. Like, how did I get here? You know what I'm talking about? I'm sure you feel the same way sometimes. You're like, how did I get here and learn all this? And now it's wholly applicable to your life, right? Like, this foundation that you set for yourself now is sort of paying off, at least just in terms of maybe a better understanding, or overstanding, as I like to say it, of the world that you're operating in. So, back to the notice just for a moment, in terms of the effectiveness of this notice, the results that you've seen from this process have little to do with the piece of paper itself. Instead, they have more to do with the person filling out that paper. You've said you've had spotty results because this has more to do with the inner man or the inner woman more than it does paperwork or court tactics. You have to change inside. And Cal, I know that we just met, you don't know me, but the folks who have listened to me for years now know that I'm big into personal transmutation, that internal alchemy, so to speak, the change inside. I like to think of it as a blend of psychological, emotional, and spiritual progress. And maybe you agree, or maybe we could argue about that nuance, but I'm curious, going back to your own journey here, when did you first notice that this change was happening inside of you?
It happened early. I've sort of had that already happening, but when I was thrust into the court, I'm pretty intuitive and I can kind of read body language without, I don't technically read it or haven't studied, but I can read body language. I can tell what's going on intuitively. And so I did glean that there was something happening. I couldn't put my finger on it. Once I started doing commerce, the very first move we made, the judge ran out of the room, but we didn't know why he was running out of the room. as we were coming in. He was just running out of the room and we didn't see the cause and effect. So, you know, coming to understand this, and then a lot of the spiritual things we did, prayers, we noticed that especially those at the very top seemed to understand what it was we were doing. So that you kind of go, okay, they know more than I do, and yet they're reacting to this. So I'm doing something. So then you have to kind of come to grips with that. Like there's something happening because of what I'm doing. And it's not necessarily the piece of paper, because we also experienced more than once where you're writing something on your computer to send to somebody and they've already reacted. And so you're going, okay, what's happening here? What's the mechanism? What is that? Like, how does this work? Because there's no, and it's not coincidences. Once you get past that, because that's my first reaction is, okay, that's just a coincidence. But then it happens again. Okay, maybe it still could be a coincidence. But by the third time, at that point, I'm going, okay, you can't have this happen three times and it be a coincidence. Something is happening. And so then you just go with that. I don't know. I don't fully understand how this works. I'll try and figure it out, but I'm going to keep doing that behavior or that tactic. And a lot of what we did was through declaration, by saying it out loud. So the paper, we would, not everything, but quite a few things, I read them out loud with witnesses, and I would bring in spiritual beings, then send the paper out. And I got a lot more traction out of that than just sending pieces of paper, although that did work as well. So then you go, okay, is that a coincidence? And then you do it again, and you start to realize that there's more going on here than what we've been told, and it has to do with what's happening inside me. It's my, literally my belief, if you want to say it that way, but it's not even a belief, it's a knowing. Like I know that this floor, if I walk across it, it's going to hold me up. I can't explain fully why, because if I walk across water, it doesn't hold me up. And you know, you can get into the scientific things of that, but I think there are people who can walk on water, because it's not about the properties of it. It's about knowing about something. So this is no different. We try and get people to read the document numerous times so that it starts to internalize, and we're getting the feedback that it's changing their lives in other aspects of their lives.
Yeah. Like, again, that's very similar to a magical working or like a magical spell. Like, it just seems like it really is about the belief in it. And I have a quote here from your website that does speak more to this change, but you wrote that most are hopeful, but hope needs to change to faith. That is when the change will manifest into reality, because that is the way reality works. There is nothing that can stop it. And I think that that is a great encapsulation of what we're talking about here, is that it's one thing to, you know, hope for change, but it's another thing to have faith that change will happen.
Yes. And that's what we want to have. We want to have a group of people working together with that same belief in varying degrees, but still knowing that this is going to work and knowing that the change is coming, and even preparing for it, like thinking. I try and tell people, like when you're at work and you know you're going on holidays in 2 weeks, there's that excitement, and you can kind of, you know it's coming, and so you endure the work or whatever, and knowing that, okay, I'm going to be on the beach in 3.5 days. We have to get to that kind of state inside where we know there's a change coming, and we embody it and welcome it and believe it's going to happen as if it's going to happen.
Well, I think belief is also kind of, to me, it's also what you want to happen, right? Like, you tend to put that energy towards things that you want to happen. And a lot of times, you know, people will put themselves into fear, and they will want these terrible things to happen because they're in that fear mindset. And that's just where that energy is focused, right? So this is just a complete 180 in terms of, let's get more into love, let's get more into faith and charity, and let's focus towards those common ends and goals, and then see what manifests from there. So
exactly.
Let's shift gears then back to the Bible. I mentioned earlier, you call the Bible a contract. You also call it the rules of engagement, like I said. And I think a lot of people who interact with the text would be surprised to know that it has something to do with law or contract even. And I'm curious, you know, where could you point people directly if they just wanted to see this in action on the page itself? Where and how can this be read as a lawful document?
Well, walk down to the building called your courthouse and see if they got one there. That should tell you something. Right there. I mean, why is it there? It used to be in the schools. If you're old enough to know that, it was in the schools. They took it out. They did not take it out of the court. There's a reason why, not because they want it there, because it has to be there. And so that tells you something right away, that the court has to have it there. And then you have to ask why. When you read the Queen's coronation oath, it's very clear that it's a contract. She has to defend that and the Anglican Protestant doctrine based on the Bible, so not the Catholic one. And one of her titles is Fidei Defensor, Defender of the Faith. And so she gets all these possessions as her part of the deal, because that's really what it says, possessions. But she has to uphold this. This becomes the contract. This becomes the rules of this deal, the terms of the contract. So there's been a vilification of the Bible for centuries, and most people don't read it because they have an opinion about it, which is not their own opinion because they haven't read it. You can't have an opinion on something that you have never experienced. That's your own opinion. You picked it up from somebody else. And I've just noticed that, you know, when I do live speaking engagements, I always ask the question, who does not have an opinion about the Bible? So far, two people. So again, what does that tell you? Why does everybody have an opinion about that? Like, you know, 99.9999% of the people have an opinion about something. And then you ask how many have read it and you see about 10%. So it's like, okay, 80% of you have an opinion about it, but have no idea what it says or anything really about it. You've never read it. So that's how I kind of came to the Bible. And then just the way that they changed the alphabet in order to change every verse in that book is just astounding in and of itself. But it can't be a coincidence that by changing the alphabet and some spelling conventions that you affected one book in particular, every verse.
Yeah. And the version that you're talking about is the 1611 King James Bible. Words are spelled differently. Some letters were switched around. It affected every verse in the book. And I've heard you say that they, whoever they are in this case, but they meant to attack this book in particular, this version. Why was this version singled out?
Because that's the contract. When you look at the Queen's oath, that would have been a 1611 that she kissed and put her hand on and swore. So technically, you know, technicalities of law, technically, if you use the authorized version, again, authorized, it's not the correct one. Even though they didn't change any words in it, the spellings are all different. So technically, she doesn't have to uphold that one.
Yeah. And I think this might go back to what we were talking about a few minutes ago with that change inside of you. But I've heard you say before that something happens in your brain when you read this version of the Bible, when you read these weird spellings, these different spellings that we've not been subjected to, that we've not read before. I think it might have something to do with some sacred geometrical stuff. I've heard you talk about the phi spiral being part of this as well. Yeah. Could you talk more about that? Like, why do you think that there are these weird things happening when you read this version of that text?
I think it has something to do with the letters themselves, and they switched it out and they switched it everywhere. So we're not reading what they would have read 400 years ago. And so, you know, with gematria, et cetera, and every letter having a number and all these things, all those codes would be different. Everything would be different as far as, you know, what we're reading and how our brains are processing that, for those that understand any of that stuff. And it's with the rest of everything that we're reading now too. So, you know, I studied one guy, he thinks we're reading backwards because most of the ancient languages, they write from right to left and we read the other way, right? And then there's all these, the thing about Led Zeppelin and some backward speaking things and other things. You can look a lot of stuff up. Obama's speech when he first got in. These are not sort of happenstances when you sort of think the language might be backwards. And even the word backwards is backwards. So when I see that this is, you know, happening and the Bible seems to be at least one of the main targets, that's when I want to, okay, I need to read that because somebody's trying to hide that and they're going through great pains. So as far as the phi spiral stuff, that is from the original languages. So the ancient Hebrew and Aramaic, the letters themselves have meanings. And then when you put them in words, they have deeper meanings. And then the words in the sentence have deeper meanings. The whole thing is like a big code of layers of understanding. Then the letters themselves are part of a phi spiral looking from different angles. Also can be a man's hand can make them. So when you see all that, it's like, okay, who did this? How did you get all these codes in there? You know, supposedly we didn't have computers. So what's the mechanism of this? And why is it like that? And who did it and who was supposed to see it or find it or be the, you know, the recipient of this. So it's a very high intelligence extremely high intelligence did it, and who was supposed to see it? That's when you start to get into, okay, I'm here for a reason, and something very, very, very ancient and very intelligent is trying to communicate with me. And I'm supposed to be able to see this. So I must have at least some kind of intellect along those lines too.
Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to verify something too. Is the 1611 version, is that the same Bible that sits in these courtrooms, or is it another version?
They'll have different versions in there, but they will have a Bible. There's patriot lore out there that they have to have a 1611. I don't know if that's true or not, because I don't go into every courtroom. And
you haven't been to every courtroom? What? What are you doing? Come on.
Yeah. So I've heard, but again, this might be that patriot lore, what I call patriot lore. And there's a lot of that out there. So I don't know that for a fact, but the fact that they have any kind of version of the Bible in there tells you something.
Does that lessen its importance as a spiritual text to you, the fact that it is in these law or legal settings, or does it just maybe enhance the spiritual teachings?
Well, again, it's a contract. So if you look at it as a contract, there has to be at least two parties in a contract. So who are the parties, and why is this contract present in every courtroom? Because that's the contract. That's the law. It's in evidence in every case, put it that way. But nobody brings it up. Nobody talks about it because we haven't read it and we shun it. And so it's right there, but nobody's aware of what the significance of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think what I was trying to get at was, if we look at it as a contract, does it take away from the way that we've interpreted the book for all these centuries, that it's a spiritual doctrine? Does it take away from the spiritual side of things if we only look at it in a lawful way?
No, it doesn't. Because again, it's as above, so below. So everything that we're seeing here is based on something else. That's why I said, it's funny that the law merchant is following biblical principles. And I noticed it. It was like, okay, is that really happening? And then, or is that just a coincidence? And then you start to look and no, this is actually happening. The principles are the same. They're just doing it in a different way, using money and law and all that. So everything that's happened, like even the common law, if you go back to Blackstone's commentaries, which they're trying to vilify those now, they've stood the test of time for a long time. But even that, if you start to read some of what he was saying, it was based on biblical law, based on the understanding of God and a created man. And that's, again, that's why they want to vilify it, because they don't want anybody seeing that. Once you get past the idea of Big Bang theory and a rock and life just formed out of nothing, as soon as you introduce God, then you have to say, what does God think about this? And that's when things start to change.
How do you define God these days?
Well, he's not definable. He's not a gender either. The way it's described in some of the oral teachings is unfathomable intellect, present everywhere, because it's beyond the idea of space and time. There are attributes. Those don't change. Like the beginning of all things, like the original consciousness, and everything else is really because of his idea to do it.
So similar question, different wording, I think. I mentioned earlier, when I introduced you, you put the word author and authority. What does that word authority mean to you now? How has its definition changed to you over time as you've gotten more spiritual and more lawful?
Personally, I have a profound authority in the spirit realm, to the point where I know it and they know that I know it, and we're past that. They don't, where's your authority? I don't get questioned. Like that's not even, doesn't even come up. That happened because of the document I wrote to, I had it before, but when I wrote to the Queen and I challenged her oath, and I did it up in spiritual realms, I put that in the documentation going up into principalities, powers, rulers, etc. So they all ended up on this default. If she defaults, you're defaulting all the way up your whole structure. And they went into default, and my spiritual authority went way, way up. And it took me a while to, come to grips with it. Is this really happening? And, that kind of thing. Because I'm not a skeptical person, but I don't just jump to conclusions. I try and do a scientific thing like, okay, that happened. If it's an actual thing, it should be repeatable. That's how I do things. So when something repeats three times, and I'm pretty sure it's cause and effect kind of thing.
So on Earth here, there's the illusion that there are certain types of people that have authority over you, certain types of beings that have authority over you. In the spiritual realm that you're talking about, is that the case too?
No, there's hierarchies, there's jurisdictions, there's rulers and principalities and these types of beings. I want to correct you on that too. It's in Earth, not on Earth.
I had a note on that, and I'm glad that you mentioned it. Go ahead, tell people what you mean by that.
Well, even in the Lord's Prayer, a lot of us say it, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. It's actually, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. It's an in, we're inside of something, not on something. And that's just a play on words, but it makes you think a certain way, that we're on a planet and the planet is part of something else and everything else. But we're actually in something, inside of something.
Well, I will not ask you about flat earth right now, because I feel like there might be some parallels to those theories these days in terms of what we might be in or whatever. So
again, in the book of Job, that's another thing that really made me understand that this is a contract and there's a, this court system. The book of Job starts with a court proceeding. The Most High is there. And then the sons of God assemble, apparently to have cases heard, because the only case that's heard, of those sons of God was Satan's. So Satan appeared and God said, where have you been? And he said, I've been in the earth, wandering back and forth in it. So it means when I was remanded for 60 days, I was in something and it was very closed in, and I was able to go to court. They would come and get me in the sheriff's trucks, and take me to court, but then back to the inside something. And that's how I saw it for the first time, because I'd been through that. So he's saying, I'm in something. When you start to look at NASA and the moon landing, et cetera, and some of the things that are said around that, I don't want to get into the flat earth thing either, but I can definitely say that NASA is lying about this whole space idea. And I don't think they've been able to get out. And then when I read some of the stories in the Bible, like around the Tower of Babel, and then if you understand what's going on with the Giza pyramid structure and some of the other ancient structures around, a lot of those were trying to get out of this thing. These are escape things, well, at least part of their aspects. So it started to dawn on me, I think we're in a prison. We're not the prisoners. Somebody was in prison here, and we were put here in order to adjudicate something very ancient. Because once Satan's case starts, because after he says, I've been remanded over here in earth. Oh, Job, that's his case. So when they're calling Satan's case, it's about Job. That is the whole case. There's nothing else spoken about. So Job is the subject of Satan's case. And the matter at hand is, if I can do certain things to him, he will curse you to your face. That's what it's all about.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about the prison planet concept or theory. I've heard that for years. And I think I heard, to be honest, I heard Alex Jones talking about that way back in the 90s. And it sat with me. And, he talks about it, and conspiracy theorists talk about it in a very dark, negative way, in that you're just stuck here and you're stuck here forever, and you reincarnate and you can't get out until you do something, maybe. I don't know. So,
yeah, I think there are some beings who can't get out.
To me, I think it would be maybe this, for lack of a better way to describe them, let's call them like the lizard class. They're the ones who I feel like probably can't get out. And so, like any good narcissist does, they just sort of drag you down with them, right? Like, if I can't leave, then you can't leave.
Yeah. And then they've tried different technologies to get out, including rockets and CERN and the pyramids. And even breeding into the one being who can get out or has the capacity to do it. So there's that interbreeding with the DNA of Adam. And it's always been about controlling the DNA of Adam or destroying it or breeding into it. And we're in that final stage of that now, where they want to manipulate the DNA of Adam.
That's actually a good segue. And let's come back, I guess, into Earth, so to speak, and talk a little bit about what you call the four agendas. I'd modify that slightly and call them the four commercial agendas, but just because of the way that you talk about them. You mentioned smart meters. That's kind of how you got started with your notice of liability with the smart meter issue. That's one of the four. And then there's 5G, geoengineering, and forced vaccinations. And you have said that these agendas, are offers in commerce. And I was wondering if you could expound on that for us. What do you mean when you say that these are commercial offers to us?
Just so you understand, these are weapons. They're weapon grade, every one of them. You can dissect them and go, yeah, this is a weapon grade thing. But normally weapons are moved through standing armies. Like, you know, the Second World War, the Germans came with tanks and cannons and men and guns and all that kind of stuff. And so it was very clear to see what was going on. Now they're moving through commerce and they're getting us to buy in. So you'll get flyers, you'll get advertisements. Everything is done in a commercial way, the way they sell a car or a pair of Levi's. They're selling vaccinations, they're selling 5G, they're selling the smart meters, and even the geoengineering, though it's going to save you from your suntan getting too dark or whatever it is, right? But it's all weapon grade stuff.
Yeah, you said that they were military deployments. I mean, that's how you've talked about them recently. And I thought that's an interesting way to put it, because a lot of these things do start as, you know, seemingly innocuous research projects in military and government programs. So
yeah,
it's not far-fetched for me to look at it that way. But I do want to talk about, so of those four, you know, three of them, I understand the offer. So smart meters, you know, they have to come in or like around my home to pull that off. I have a question about that actually in a moment for you, but they usually send you a notice before they do it. So there's your offer, right? Vaccinations, I also get, you got to show up and roll your own sleeve up for those things. So there's your offer. 5G, I can see that with the purchase of a 5G phone, that's your consent, right? You're signing a contract with your smartphone provider and they provide you with a device that then connects to this network. So I get that. I don't understand the towers necessarily. I don't know how we're accepting those offers by those towers just being built up, but I guess maybe the continued consent of the contracts with the providers.
That's correct. Because how they did it was when cell phones came out, you had the big brick, and then they, you know, then they moved to cell, and then the 1G came out, and then 2G, and everything got better. The phones got better, connectivity got better, cameras got, everything got better. 2G, 3G, and then 4G, and then they switched it to 5G. But you would think better, 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 because they've conditioned us with that. But 5G is a whole other animal, and it doesn't even really work with the phones. It's not better. It's actually worse. And so they have to have more, way more repeaters, and therefore they can have way more coverage for what they really want to do with it.
Right. Well, so the fourth one of those is geoengineering, and I've actually done two recent episodes on that. I struggle with that one because I know it's been happening for years already without our consent. I don't recall there being an offer presented to us that like, we're going to spray your skies and, you know, terraform this planet on some level, and then us accepting that contract. So I assume that the climate change, and I'm going to call it a hoax, and if that offends you, I'm sorry, but I think the climate change story that's heating up now, I think that is probably the offer that's going to be presented, right?
Yeah. And it has been.
But in the past, I don't remember, they've been very coy about geoengineering. They never really admitted to it. So where was the offer and the consent in the past? I could see in the future how that might play out, but they've been doing it for years without what I would call consent.
Yes, they have been. And I think they just needed to correct that as they're moving towards the end of this thing. Because this whole thing is, Satan is going to stand in that court where the sons of God go and say, they agreed to this. That's going to be the argument. So part of what the notice of liability is there's going to be a pile of paper, figuratively speaking, on God's desk going, no, they did not.
Yeah, I'll go on the record and say I don't consent to that, by the way.
Yeah. So that's really all it is. They just need that tacit agreement in order to have that argument later on, you know, when things really start to fall out.
Well, I think it's important to point out too that silence is also consent, right?
That's correct.
Yeah.
It's tacit agreement. Yeah.
Yeah. It's the same thing.
Yeah.
So Cal, this has been great. I appreciate you taking so much time here to chat with us. Before we go, tell people where they can find you and your work.
InPowerMovement.com. And that's our interim website. We're building something much bigger that can handle worldwide sort of volumes. And but that we have an interim site, and it's a membership thing to a private organization. So we're creating a private organization at the same time, and you'd be a member of that. And that has a lot of benefits to it because we're out of the public and a lot can happen in the private that can't happen in the public. And so that's where we're at right now, and hopefully launching soon and getting our iron in the fire, so to speak, and see the changes happening.
For sure. So are you guys registered as a PMA then, Private Membership Association?
We're actually, we're not registered at all because Reggie, the root word is king, so you'd be handing to a king. We are a church under the Constitution of the United States. So
you're a 508c1a?
Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah, that is technically a faith-based organization that operates in the private sector, as far as I know, right? So that's not a public-facing church or a state church, right? It's a completely private entity.
Yeah, and protected by the Constitution, right in the original articles, or maybe amendment. No, it's in the original articles. And then we have an auxiliary, which is InPower, and it's an integrated auxiliary to that. And that's the public-facing thing.
Got it. Yeah. So we'll link to all that in the show notes, obviously. You know, again, thanks so much. Really enjoyed it. Could talk to you for another 4 hours if you wanted to. But yeah, thank you so much for all that you do, for real. I know that people appreciate you and your work. So, and I appreciate you being able to chat with me. So
thanks, Ryan.
All right. Take care, man.
All right. Bye-bye.
And there you have it. My thanks again to Cal Washington. So much substance here, and we really just scratched the surface. I do wish I had more time with him for this one, but I think I was able to check off most of the items on the docket that I wanted to. I've listened to Cal for a couple years now, and most people tend to focus on the legal stuff with him, and rightly so, because it's a vital component to how we're going to move forward here. But I just can't help being more impressed with the spiritual side of things that he brings. Although, if I'm being honest, there's not a whole lot of difference between law and spirituality if you grok the Bible in the way that Cal groks it. And that's something that I've woken up to in recent years. I used to shit all over that thing for a multitude of reasons. But I was one of those people Cal talks about when he says a lot of people have an opinion on the Bible, but they've never read it. And when I started reading it, I went into it with a heavy astro-theological bias, which is something I asked Cal about in the second hour. I was reading it as the Helios Biblios, the sun book, the book of the sun, looking at Jesus and the apostles as the sun and the 12 zodiac signs. And listen, I still think that perspective is valid, but listening to Cal break the good book down as he has for years now has shown new light on it for me and so many others, I'm sure. Pun intended there. But I think it's quite possible that the Bible itself is a text whose meaning changes as your own consciousness changes, or evolves as your own consciousness evolves. Cal may argue that with me because I think he might say it's the book that changes your consciousness, but I think it's the other way around. I think as your consciousness upgrades, that what you interact with, the things you've interacted with so many times before, they suddenly take on new meaning. I've experienced that myself in other areas. Even with something as innocuous as reading a novel or watching a film or listening to a song I've heard 1,000 times, suddenly you find more depth to it, more layers, more meaning, different meaning. And I think that as you become more spiritual, as I have and as I'm sure so many of you have, you also start to see things in a new light. And in a way I don't quite yet comprehend, I think that when the idea of true freedom or true sovereignty seems more real and more attainable, your reality becomes even more permeable, more magical, more attuned to your own resonance. And you start to see not just the beauty and the synchronicity in all things, but you also start to see how all the things were constructed and designed in the first place. I've been digging more into matters of law like this the last couple years, and what I've gathered is that the system itself is not broken. It's not working against you. It's nothing to fear. In fact, it's something to love and cherish and admire, because it's been constructed and designed intelligently for your benefit. It is literally perfect, if you know how to use it. And sadly, many of us don't. Which is why I want to talk to guys like Cal. Selfishly, it's for my own edification, because I find this subject to be endlessly fascinating. It encapsulates so many of my interests, language, creativity, magic, spirituality. I even think there's some alchemy in there. But most of all, it's practical. It's a solution in times where we need more of them as we continue to navigate this earthly realm here, which becomes seemingly more convoluted and complex by the day. But the solutions are always simple, and this is one of them. So this is a thread I'm going to continue to pull on, not just for the podcast here, but in my actual day-to-day life. Personally, I did join the InPower Movement because I've been dealing with a smart meter issue myself. I needed some legal resources to use to my advantage. I actually asked Cal about this in the second hour, which I'm now officially calling Detox Extra, because, well, yeah, because it's so extra. So with that in mind, I rebranded the Patreon so you can support the show there now. I didn't want to use Patreon because I hate it, but I had a couple listeners nudge me back in that direction, and you got to go where your audience is. So patreon.com/detox, D-T-O-X-X-X-X. You can still get the second hour on Substack as well, and I'll soon be offering the same option on detox.com. I need to migrate the website from Squarespace to WordPress. WordPress is more user-friendly on the back end with their membership options, so that should be up and running in the next few weeks, hopefully. But $7 a month will get you the second hour of all episodes. I did structure the Patreon with multiple tiers to accommodate people who were still subscribed under the old culture tiers. So $2 a month there will get you early access to the free one-hour episodes. $5 will get you early access plus some bonus content here and there at my discretion. $7 gets you that plus the second hour, of course, and there's a $10 option where you get your name in the show notes as an executive producer. I know that's not really too enticing, but people are still subbed at that level, and I had to think of something, so there's that. And in that second hour, as I mentioned, I asked Cal about my own smart meter issue, as well as how to shift liability back to certain product manufacturers with Cal's notice of liability. You can read between the lines on that one. I also asked Cal about Babylon, Revelation 18, and the importance of language in the Bible and in law. Cal talked a little bit about sound, frequency, and speaking backwards. We got into soul contracts and multigenerational contracts, sin equaling debt and the debt clock, lawful claims in the spirit realm, lawful claims on earth, and Satan's appeal, which may or may not be happening right now, the big shift, potential DNA upgrades, and the sun, the reappearance of the Book of Enoch and its role in the big shift, slowing down time, space and time non-existing together, Cal's drumming influences because he is a drummer, as well as his thoughts on Rush's Neil Peart, Tool's Danny Carey, and jazz music. Nice little tangent there. Got back into law, talking a little bit about quantum language. I asked him about the best version of Black's Law Dictionary to get. And we wrapped the chat with my favorite question about what is love. We also got into a little bit about love and fear and how they work together. So again, for $7 a month, you too can be oh so extra. Pop up in the show notes, click the links, and sub your little hearts out. You can also support some other business endeavors of mine, Bust the Agenda, where I'm gathering supplies to make orgone energy devices. Check out the recent episode with Mitch the Orgone Donor for more on that. And Soul Source, the holistic wellness sanctuary, where I'm trying to raise about $25,000 for a private membership club centered on holistic wellness. I was originally trying to raise much more than that, but decided that I didn't really need all that up front. So a much more modest fundraiser there. Still a lot of money, of course. But I'd appreciate any donation, no matter how big or small it is. So if you can spare anything this time of year, and I know times have been tough for a lot of us, but if you can spare a dime or a dollar, I would be eternally grateful. Anyway, that's enough for me. So that's a wrap on yet another episode. Until next time, you know what to do. Love yourself. Think for yourself and reclaim authority.
Thank you.